Okay, we're back with Keith, and I thought something that might be real interesting for the audience out here, since we have you here, take advantage of your skills, and we don't get action star writers and producers here very often, would be to give you a chance to maybe critique some of our local talent.
I'm always looking for new talent, so let's see what they have to offer.
I mean, we have so many folks in the area that think that they can, you know, because they have great kicks or they have great stances or they do great kata, that automatically somebody looks at them and says, you should be in the movie. How often do you find that to be the case?
Very rarely, because we're looking for the whole package. We're looking for action as well as being able to act.
Mm-hmm.
So let's see what they have.
Well, I tell you what, we're going to come back and talk in just a minute, but why don't we break away for just a second, and we got a couple of local guys here to put together a little skit for you, and let's see how they do.
All right, sounds good.
Yo, how much?
They don't need to put like five.
Boom.
Mike took the stage, man.
I
told you to beat me, man. I couldn't beat
brother,
you. Man, in the first place, by
excuse
myself,
me,
man.
Watch things.
I gotta get off this corner with that. I can't handle it in this community, man.
What's up with you, man? You don't run the show, brother. You ain't
gonna do that. What's that? What's that? We can finish this now, man. Call it quits. Told you selling and dealing in this community is bad, man. You losers.
Now, what did you think about that, Keith? That was serious action, wasn't
it? I thought these guys were very talented. In fact, one of the biggest parts about fighting is the reactions. And I thought you guys did a great job of reactions.
Yeah, I've heard that the good fight scenes have more to do with the extras, how they react, than it does with the guy sometimes that's actually fighting.
That's right, and that's why so many of the extras have to be real stuntmen, because if you hit somebody and they don't move, it makes you look like you're not hitting with any power.
Now, how long did you guys get a chance to work on that?
We just started working on it today with the help of good choreographer, Shifu Bone.
So we okay.
Together.
But so, and a lot of people think that you guys probably would work on something like that like 3-4 hours, but in reality, you only have a few minutes sometime to put that stuff together.
Yes, sir.
I know, especially in the movies. I mean, when you're shooting a movie and you've got to get like 5 or 6 scenes in, the average fight scene, you may have just what, a short period of time.
Well, you have a very limited amount of time to put it together. And that's a shock to most martial artists because they're used to practicing kata for hours on end.
Mm-hmm.
And they come onto the set and they're given 5 minutes to get something ready and they're going, wait a minute, I can't do that.
Well, the guy does what I did when I did my little shot in the movie. It went against my principle. It says, that's not my style. I mean, I wouldn't kick to the head. We never kick above the waist. And, you know, you're just a hard person to deal with. You run into those.
Oh, all the time. And it's very important to remember that it's entertainment. And even Bruce Lee said that, you know, I'd kick somebody in the street low, but I'd kick him in the head for the movies, and because it looks better, like that kick you gave to the head there, that was a beautiful kick. But you wouldn't necessarily throw that in the street, right?
Yes, sir.
Sometimes you have to exaggerate the movement. So to people coming up and say they may be good martial artists and they want to kind of break in this field, they've got to be flexible, be willing to be flexible, I would think.
Exactly. And it's very important for them to get a video camera and try some of the scenes that they run some fight scenes through and see how it looks on the video, because you learn very quickly what works on screen and what doesn't.
Oh, okay. Well, that's real good. Now, you have a movie coming up soon, right?
Right. American Shaolin. It's called American Shaolin. It'll release in early 1993 on video. So
okay.
Please go see it, and I hope you enjoy it.
And we're going to be looking for it in this area real soon, and hopefully when it opens, we can get you back on Martial Arts Showcase to kind of pump that thing up again.
That'll be great. Okay.
Okay. That's Martial Arts Showcase, and it's been great having you here. Keith Strandberg, you remember that name. Look for him in the credits, because a lot of those action films, you may not see him on the screen, but he has a lot to do with that.
That's
and
right.
Thank you also, Bam, and all the guys, and we'll see you on Martial Arts Showcase. Okay, we're back with Martial Arts Showcase. That was, we kind of went off a few minutes ago with a clip from one of your movies. That's some awesome work.
Yeah, that was from, actually that was from Film Fest DC, which is a promo that airs here in the DC area in the various movie theaters around town during the months of May and April, I believe.
Well, that's the point we're making. You're doing some good work. I heard that you're doing a stunt appearance actually in the new Malcolm X movie.
Yeah, I was supposed to do some work in Universal Soldier,
uh-huh.
And I gave that up because I wanted to do Malcolm. I mean, Malcolm was more important to me, and I got to do a little scene where after Malcolm is shot and two of the guys who are coming out,
mm-hmm.
As they run out, I tackle a couple of them, take them down a flight of stairs, and throw a couple of punches. So,
look for him. That's him in that
martial
movie.
Arts,
and you've done a couple other stunts. What's something else you may have done that we may have seen that?
Just recently, around Christmas time, a movie should be coming out called Meteor Man.
Uh-huh.
Robert Townsend. I doubled Robert Townsend. Also,
okay.
Played a little part. Not played a stunt part in that as one of a gang member, kind of like. And doubled Eddie Murphy, actually, in Boomerang.
Well, we knew you were going to eventually get around to having to do some Eddie Murphy doubles. So you actually got to do something in the Boomerang?
Yeah, it was a real experience. And
give me one little sneaky thing in there that we may not know about the movie.
Well, actually, what I ended up doing got cut from the movie because the movie was
well, that's the part we want to hear about. Yeah,
it was over 3 hours long, and the fight scene that I had was in a bar. Not in a bar, it was in a club, actually, with the guy who did capoeira, which is the...
They cut the capoeira out of the movie?
They cut the capoeira.
The brothers always die. I can't tell them to put
you're
that...
Going to cut
we're
going to
have
them
put that back in to the uncut version. Well, I tell you what, let's see a little bit of your work, if you would. Let's just actually show the audience a little bit about how a fight scene is done. Before we get into that, let's have you demonstrate this a little bit. We have Willie the Bam Johnson, aspiring star here helping you out. And I'm going to back out and get out of the way.
Okay, basically, a lot of things, what goes into making a fight scene look real? A lot of times, people, if you're in martial arts and you want to get into movies, you have to realize it's a whole different area, it's a whole different thing. And I always get people ask me, you still working out? You still keeping in shape? You have to be in shape to do movies, because it's not like being in shape for martial arts is one thing, but when you have to do a fight scene for 12 hours a day, over and over and over and over, you have to be in shape for that. One thing that makes that look good, though, is the angles, okay? Now, you see, if I throw a hook punch, a snapping hook like that, that might not look, that looks like something that would work in the street, maybe, bang. But on film, that would be a lot too short. So if I have him, this would be the angle. If I did like this, it looks more like a jab. So if I want to throw a hook, I have to wing it. I have to bring it way out.
I have to exaggerate the movement.
So people will think, oh, man, I wouldn't throw a punch like that. You have to learn if you want to be in a movie. So as opposed to doing this, I'm going to do this.
Ah, yeah, it makes it look real.
Bigger. Plus, the angle is real important because in real life, I'm not, bang, hitting him on the chin. I'm way out here. And literally, I can be this far away. If I turn him around, you can't really tell how far away I am. Mm-hmm. I can be back here.
Yeah.
Like a hit.
Yeah.
And it's not. Okay, same thing with kicks. Say if I'm throwing a round kick, okay? If I throw a round kick, I can throw one out here. Well, that's a miss, okay? So I have to put it deeper in. I have to put it deeper into his body so I can come here.
Look real, didn't it? Look real from here.
But in real life, I'm standing here. You see where that is.
It's
not really in there. Sometimes you do contact. They'll slow the film down and let you just bang and tap somebody, okay? Mm-hmm. And what else? Body shots. Say he throws a punch here. Boom, I come down here and I want to do a body shot. Boom, when I'm hitting with the body, I'm actually doing a movement with my body that's helping him so it looks more real. So I'm not just going boom and hitting him in the body. Shift.
Yeah.
Okay.
Did so you he hit you that time, didn't he? It looked real to me.
The other part is him reacting. So when you do get tapped quite a bit, you always get tapped.
Let me ask you something, Chuck. I remember someone telling me, and I did movies years ago, mm-hmm. but I remember them saying that one of the best stars in Hong Kong at that time was, what's his name? The new Bruce Lee, not the new Bruce Lee, but Jackie Chan.
Oh, Jackie Chan.
And I remember them saying that the reason his stuff was so good is because he had the best stuntmen, I mean the best, what do you call them, the guys that react?
Stunt, crazy people.
They make you look good. So a big part of you reacting has to do with the guys that are out here. If they really react well, it makes you look even better.
Most definitely.
Yeah.
Most definitely. And there are different ways of taking punches. You take a big punch, you take a punch that's not so big. You take a punch that you can stand there a little bit longer. Say if he threw a hook punch at me here, I can take it like and go ham, or I can take it like this. So I'm ready for another technique to come. Different ways of snapping your head, different ways of putting your body.
Mm-hmm.
So all of that is real important.
So that's a whole nother side of stunts, the guys that are giving it and the guys that are taking it. So because if you got a guy here like me and you throw the punch and I'm trying to be cool, it doesn't look like anything, right?
I've had a guy one time actually snap his head the opposite way into a technique by accident. You know, we're going through the fight scene, he snapped his head this way and I had a kick coming this way. So when he snapped,
and they kept that in though, didn't they?
They sure did.
Gee, let me do something real quick. Let me get you to actually put together a little quick scene for me,
if
you could.
All right. Say we'll have Bam come in. The Bam come in. He throws a jab. Boom. Throws his hand. Boom. From there, round kick. My fault. Let's do that again. Throws a jab. Bang. Bang. Round kick. Bang. Back fist. Boom.
Uh huh.
Throw a round kick here. Then we'll have this guy come in. As he comes, bang. Okay. Just give
it. Okay. So let me see you do that.
Okay, let's try.
Let me see what that looks like.
You didn't tell me he was coming.
He was only two guys. No, we're just kidding. They won't. Come on up, guys. Would that ever happen, though? I mean, are you that aware? Would that ever really happen?
We don't get
to lock it and rock it, and
we don't encourage people to just walk on the set and fight scene. Wouldn't be too smart. Excuse me.
Oh, that's very good. Well, you guys were good, but I'm seeing that now. One of the things I saw is timing has a lot to do with that.
Yeah.
Has a lot to do with
most
that.
Definitely.
Yeah. You know, if this guy comes too soon, he can actually get hit. Now they told me that, and you hear all kind of rumors that in Bruce Lee's movies in the early days, his timing either wasn't that great or he wanted to make it look even realer, so he would actually put wood in here and actually.
Right. So sometimes what would happen, guys would come in and they would get in a little too close. Actually, during the Film Fest DC, there's a part that's cut out where a guy came a little bit further over the line. I kept telling him, don't come over the line. I bounced off the wall and threw a kick, and he ended up coming over the line and knocked him out. Yeah, so.
Well, we're looking forward to seeing you in some other movies, and thanks a lot, guys, for helping us out in this.
Thank you.
We're going to be looking for you in some films, in front of the camera, behind the camera. This is Chuck Jeffries. For all those folks that knew him when I knew him, this is The Bone. He's going to be out there under whatever name, superstar. We'll be right back in just a minute with our technique of the week. Thank you, Bone. All right.
Look, you weren't there. Neither one of you guys were there. So why don't you just get out of my face, all right?
What do we got here?
Has the bus come yet?
Oh no, it's on its way. Should be coming to the
club. That was a joint, man. That club was kicking like a
slam.
Hey, what's up with you, man? Hey, why you looking at my girl like that, man?
No, I was just looking that way, man. You know.
Nah, you looking at my girl, man. What you doing my girl for? Nah, you gotta go to
the
way.
You like that,
man? You looking at my girl like that, man?
Man, honestly, it wasn't like that.
You want some trouble, son?
I don't want no trouble, man.
You must want some trouble.
Nah, bro, I don't want no trouble.
You got something?
I got you, man.
Okay, here we are at our technique of the week. Now, as you saw in that clip that just ran, we had two important things going on there, and this is for the youngsters. You saw the first line of self-defense was that the two youngsters, when they realized that there was danger, the first thing they did is look at each other and get out of there. And that's something that's very important. When you know there's something getting ready to go down at school, at home, whatever, and it might be impending danger, the first thing you can do is just get out of there. But now let's go to the scene, and let's set that scene up that we had. What we had here was a young man reading the paper, and maybe he was a little bit wrong. How many of us have not found ourselves looking at a pretty girl as she goes by? But in this case, it just turned out to be somebody's girlfriend who was a little bit uptight. But what happened here, we found ourselves being attacked. In this case, the gentleman reached for his throat, obviously trying to choke him or to take him out, and he found himself being choked. Now, there are three lines of self-defense we're going to talk about: neutralizing, and then going from neutralizing to controlling, from controlling to termination. Neutralizing means, first of all, stopping the attack. In this case, he placed the thumb against the back of the hand and then rolled that hand over using pressure against the joint to stop the attack. Now, in some cases, that's enough. You can just apply the pressure, maybe the guy will take the hint. In this case, obviously, that wasn't going to do it. So what he did is moved on to the next stage, which is controlling. He stepped around, using the pressure against the elbow, he locked down. Now that pressure against the elbow, pressure here and here, was just enough to hold the man in check. Once he has him in check, he's in control, he has to determine, do I need to terminate or take him out or not? In this case, he realized there may be more danger, I had better go ahead and clean this up. So he used his leverage to slam the head into the chair. Once that's done, he is now aware, and again, staying focused, making sure that you check to see if there's any other danger. In this case, he saw the attack continuing, and he followed through as the man came in with a kick to the knee, taking him out. Now, he didn't go to the chest, he didn't go to the stomach, he didn't try to do a Bruce Lee kick across the head. He says, what are the weakest points I see? The groin, or in this case, the kneecap. He went towards the weakest point because the man was much bigger. Let me use something that will work. And he took him out with a side kick to the knee. Okay, come on up. So when you're working with it, you have to remember one of the most important things is check for impending danger and then try to stay focused. Go towards the weakest points. Not always the most colorful technique, but something that's going to save your life. Okay, remember out there, our point for this technique, let's stay focused. That's our technique of this week. We're out of here.
Ah!
Okay, and here we are at our self-defense technique of the week, where we try to teach you a very practical technique for the streets. Now again, this technique is not really meant for the trained martial artist. This is something that hopefully anyone in the street that finds himself in this type of situation will be able to effectively do. So what you just saw was the street scene. Now what we want to do is go back and show you exactly what the young lady did in that scene, and then we're going to let you go back and walk through. And what we had is our hoodlum, which actually was one of our black belts here in the school, where he had grabbed the pocketbook, and you notice that she found herself sitting here screaming and yelling, trying to get away from the pocketbook. The first thing you have to do actually is to compose yourself, because if you just fall apart, then you can't do anything. But once you've got yourself together, you're coming up and you notice that the first technique she did was to neutralize the situation. It was a front snap kick to the groin. Again, in that case, most of the time that's going to end it, because he's going to let the pocketbook go, and then my advice would be to take off running. But in this case, for some reason, he still managed to hold on and grip that pocketbook. She followed through with a follow-up technique, which was a knee where she pulled it into his face. Again, if he hadn't let go, then the cleanup technique, she actually came across and used her weight to bring her elbow right down on the base of the neck. Okay? Let's try that one more time, but now we're going to let you do it since you worked it in the scene. Again, what we saw there in that earlier scene was the young lady, he grabbed the pocketbook. Her first thing was to hold on to her money. She's trying to do that, and that's what we all tend to do just instinctively. Now what happened is once she composed herself, there was a front snap kick to the knee, to the groin, coming down now with that knee into his face. She grabbed for balance, locked that elbow in there good and tight, and then she came over the top with that elbow into the base of his spine. Okay, coming on up. Now again, we try to tell you that when you work on these, if it's a situation where you think it's life-threatening, then just let the money go and let them take off running. If you find yourself in a situation where you think, maybe I might be in a little trouble here, then you want to try to defend yourself. Here, the technique to the groin, and keep in mind, we say there's no such thing as dirty fighting. If you can get away from it without fighting, then that's what we want you to do first. If you can get out of it by just letting your money go, then obviously that's a much better situation. These techniques are only for a last resort if you find yourself in a situation where you're out there by yourself, you're going to have to do something. Take time and practice. Take the technique over and over and over and practice, practice, practice. And keep in mind that the only people that you have to get even with are those folks who have done something good for you. That's our technique for this week. Okay, that's our show for today, and we look forward to seeing you again next week on Martial Arts Showcase.
No, not enough.
Martial Arts Showcase from the nation's capital with Master Dennis Brown.
Hello, I'm Dennis Brown, and welcome to Martial Arts Showcase, where we'll keep you up to date with the latest news and events in the world of martial arts. We'll introduce you to the superstars and foremost representatives of the world of martial arts. Today's guest is Willie the Bam Johnson. Willie the Bam Johnson is very unique in that he has set a record in America today by being the first wushu stylist to be rated in the three major categories of martial arts. Two different levels of forms, two weight classes of fighting, and weapons. Very unique. We'll be right back with Willie the Bam Johnson. Okay, we're back with Martial Arts Showcase and our very special guest, Willie the Bam Johnson. Welcome to the show, Bam.
How you doing, sir?
Okay. Well, for the audience that may not know Bam, because I've seen you many times and of course, I've worked with you, but I know there's a lot of people out there in the martial arts world who
may not be familiar with you, so we're going to try to ask you a few questions just to kind of find out where you're coming from. And in fact, where did you come from? Are you from this area, or how'd you get started in martial arts?
Well, I was born and raised in Baltimore, Maryland. Started off in the martial arts when I was 6. You know, probably like a lot of other little kids, mm-hmm. for the goal of wanting to be like Bruce Lee. Say my first Bruce Lee movie was like, yeah, I want to be just like this guy, you know?
Right.
I want to be the black Bruce Lee on a movie screen. So that was really my start. That's how I got involved. You know, I wanted to get into the movies.
Now, that far back, was there anybody really teaching youngsters at 6 years old, or did you work with someone, or how'd you get started in Baltimore?
Well, you know, it's real strange, because my family didn't even have the money to even afford classes. You know, they couldn't pay for me to study karate or kung fu. So I used to pick up books, go to the movies, and just imitate what I seen on the movie screen. You know, I just had this desire.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody couldn't stand in my way. You know, I just had to take what I seen on the screen, take what I seen in them books, and just practice. Even when people told me I couldn't, you know, reach those goals, it was like, I'm going to do it. So I really started on my own, you know.
I think a lot of martial artists kind of can relate with that, because I think anybody that started over 20 years ago, there weren't as many schools then, and a lot of us got our starts by running back and forth to New York and watching the Kung Fu movie.
Yes, sir.
A little bit of, so you come home and practice whatever. So your system kind of was whatever was in the movies that day.
Yeah.
Oh, that's really interesting. And did you work with any particular instructor? When did you start into formal? You have had formal training, is that right?
Yes, sir. I say when I was around 9, I went to a community center called McKim's Community Center, mm-hmm. and I got in contact with an instructor named Kenneth Parker, and he was skilled in Korean form of martial arts called Kangdaekwon and Wing Chun Kung Fu. And he was really impressed by, you know, with my ability. He started teaching me within about maybe 6 months or so. I got a black belt, and then I started studying with a young man by the name of Tony Lin. He started a school.
Oh, I know Tony Lin.
Sir,
you know I know, sir. Tony Lin, right?
Yes, sir.
I'll go ahead.
Sir. And when I went to his school, he was really impressed with my ability, and it was like immediately he started giving me advanced forms, put me in his advanced group, and I picked up the forms. And, you know, really, I really got the curriculum down pat. And I just happened to pick up a magazine one day. I mean, because I still wanted to move. I didn't feel like I was moving anywhere. You know, I wanted to get out there and compete. And I...
Well, you know, it's funny you mentioned Tony Lin, because I know, you know, you've worked with me and you've worked with other instructors. But that means that your first instructor, Tony Lin, or the first one that got you interested in the Kung Fu side, was my instructor's brother.
Yes, sir.
So that's kind of a coincidence. I didn't know you had studied with Tony Lin also.
Yes, sir.
And so he kind of... How would you compare that with your... You started in karate then,
mm-hmm.
is that right?
Yes, sir.
Well, how would you compare that with the training that you had in karate, or did one system fit you better than the other, or...?
I think both systems are strong, and I really appreciate the principles and the... how can I say? The technique, mm-hmm. in each system. But I came more involved in the Kung Fu because it allowed me to express my acrobatical techniques and so forth.
Mm-hmm.
It helped me to be able to relax more when I was working my techniques. You know, it wasn't really aggressive, and I really needed something. Based on my personality, I'm a real aggressive person.
Mm-hmm.
So I needed something just to help me to show the more sensitive side of me, and Kung Fu allowed me to do that.
Okay, now I know that one of your loves is competition, and in fact, that's why we have you here today, because I picked up a couple of magazines a while ago and read something that said that you were had kind of made history. You were one of the first wushu stylists not to be rated in forms or to be rated in fighting or to be rated in weapons, but the first kung fu wushu stylist to be rated in all three categories nationally at the same time. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Well, how difficult is that to do?
Well, first I have to give all praise and all just due to God,
mm-hmm.
you know, just the strength beyond my grasp. But all of my training, I always trained in each aspect, you know, forms, fighting, and weapons. Even when I was in karate, I trained in fighting, forms, and weapons. I believe in a total martial artist, you know, the complete
Let's be serious here now, because you know I'm a Kung Fu stylist,
sure.
We have to be honest. Most Kung Fu schools generally come out and they do their forms, and they're great with that. They do weapons, and that's nice, but generally what would happen is they'd come out and do their forms and weapons, and then they say, well, let's go up in the stands and let the karate guys come down and fight. So you're kind of a strange guy being a Kung Fu guy that fights, because I know from 20-some years in Kung Fu that most Kung Fu stylists are not known to be competition fighters. Is that right?
Yeah, that's true. And I believe that it's really the individual.
We're going to make some folks out there mad at us today now by saying that, but I want to take it right from you, because I know that you are a fighter,
I know you love to do forms and love to do weapons. I know guys that are great at this, great at that, but you chose to go with all three. It's very difficult to try to excel in three. There are a lot of forms competitors who can fight, but they choose to, you know, feature just the forms to try to become rated in that. It would seem that it'd be a lot more difficult to try to do all three at the same time.
You know, it's real easy for me, you know, because like I said, that's my base. That's how I came up. I always fought, I always did forms, I always did weapons. I think really when a lot of people always talk about wushu people, they can't fight. They can't fight. They just can do great forms. They can do acrobatics. They can't fight. But for me, mm-hmm. I believe it's the individual that brings something to the system. It's not the system that brings something to the individual. So it's the individual that comes into that system and brings that system alive. Mm-hmm. So when I came into Kung Fu, based on my experience in karate, all we used to do was just fight. Mm-hmm. So when I came to Kung Fu, it's like, yeah, this is my opportunity to excel, you know, to really be expressive in my style of fighting. So the wushu gives me that opportunity.
Well, let me ask you one more question, because I know we got a break here in a minute. And this question is asked a lot, I'm sure. Who are your heroes in the martial arts? In the past, present, who inspires you? Who motivates you? Because I know you've seen all of the greats traveling the national circuit.
Is it okay to say this on TV? You are one of my heroes.
Well, that's good. It's my show.
Well, that's not why I'm saying that. Yes, sir. But that's not why I'm saying that. But you're one of my heroes. Tari Cassell, you know, Charlie Lee, John Chung. I even mentioned Peter Morales, George Chung. I have a lot
These
of heroes.
These were all really great forms competitors.
Yeah, I mean, it started off with Bruce Lee being my hero, but when I got out there, and no disrespect to Bruce, but when I got out there in what I call the real world of martial arts, you seen the stuff that people that use trick cameras, they use trick cameras for those guys to be able to do on the screen, and then on the martial arts circuit, people don't need trick cameras. I mean, based on their natural ability.
I think that's great, and I hope that some of those superstars out there watching you, and we wish you a lot of success with it. We're going to come back with you in just a moment, because I think we have some footage of you actually performing, and some of the folks may not have seen you work. So what we're going to do is we're going to kind of break away right now, and we're going to come back in just a moment with Willie, I believe it is, the Bam Johnson.
Sir.
Okay, we're back with Martial Arts Showcase with our very special guest, Willie the Bam Johnson. Now, I know we talked to you earlier, Bam, about some of your many successes in martial arts on the competition circuit and just competing and becoming a super martial artist. But I know that doesn't really come easy. I mean, I know there's a certain amount of training involved with that. What does a martial artist like you do to stay in shape, and how do you train for three different categories?
Well, it all starts. I get up 6 o'clock. And move right into what I believe.
6 o'clock in the morning?
Yes, sir. Six o'clock. But it's a key for me. I go right into prayer and meditation. And I do that at least for about maybe 20 minutes or so. Mm-hmm. And then I'm off. I'm running for about an hour. And that's how I start my day. It helps me be able to clear my mind. At the same time, I listen to positive thinking tapes, musical tapes. You know, I got to stay pumped up because after the workout, I have to go into teaching. So I have to stay pumped up. I have to get get the right frame of mind, have to get the right attitude, a positive attitude. I believe that's important, your attitude. After the morning workout, I'm off to the school from 10 till 9:30 at night. I'm teaching, and I also have another workout in between the day when I should be out taking a lunch break, or when everybody else is out taking a lunch break, I'm working out for 2 hours, working my forms mm-hmm. and my weapons. And then when I start teaching classes around 4 o'clock, I'm working with the students, constantly working, putting out that energy.
That's a pretty extensive day, though, isn't it? I mean, all day long. This is a day that Bruce Lee would have envied.
Well,
yeah, most of us have to get in and do our time when we can get it in between school and work and all like that. So I guess you stay in pretty good shape.
And so it's an attitude, you know.
Well, it's worked real well for you so far. In fact, I have a surprise for you, because what we have is a clip here of you performing in one of the many competitions. This happens to be one of the national competitions, one of the AAA NASCA tournaments that are out here on the circuit. Mm-hmm. And everybody in martial arts knows exactly what NASCA is. It's North American Sports Karate, one of the major circuits. But we're going to break away here for just a second, and let's look at a little bit of you working.
Okay.
Gary, let's kick that tape.
Robert Davis on deck.
Yeah, that was great. That was great. Now, you know I like the weapons. That's my thing. When I was out there before I became an old retired has-been, I used to love to do the weapons myself. So that was real great. But I was real impressed with that fight with Marty. That was Marty Eubanks, I believe.
Sir.
Yeah, that was real sharp. I believe that was 84. He was number one in the country at that
sir.
Time.
Sir.
You remember fond memories of that? Well, okay. Well, Bam, you know, one of the things I wanted to get into before we get any further in the show is I understand that you're doing a lot of community work now, and I know that that's something that's very dear to your heart, working with youngsters, and I see you have that patch on that says Champions Against Drugs. Tell us a little bit about the work you're doing there.
Well, the Champions Against Drugs program is a national program. They have national spokespeople like John Elway, Dave Stewart,
mm-hmm.
from different sports, and they elected me as the national spokesperson for the field of martial arts.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like a personal goal for me to go back to my community and go back to the lower income communities and try to motivate the kids to believe in themselves, to help them realize that whatever they believe in, they can achieve. You know, it's just the attitude. Whatever they believe in, they can achieve. You know, that's the whole purpose. We use Champions Against Drugs, but it's about an attitude. You know, we're trying to build up their attitudes, make sure they have that
positive
attitude.
Well, I know you came up in the projects over there in Baltimore, so I guess when you go back, it's like a hometown hero. Yeah,
sir,
something like that.
Sir.
And if anything else, if nothing else, it makes the people listen to you, and maybe the youngsters feel a little bit positive about that.
Mm-hmm.
So is this something that anybody can get involved in, or is it something, because I know martial arts is still pretty much a clean sport. A lot of the other sports have been influenced by drugs, and a lot of their top players, not to say they're not drugs, people in martial arts that are not involved in drugs, but pretty much the top superstars have remained pretty much clean, I think, in the eyes of the kids. So I think we can have a major influence in the youngsters out
mm-hmm.
here.
Right. I'm trying to prevent it before it happens, you know.
Okay.
That's my main goal.
Well, I'm wishing you luck with that. And along with that, I know there are other things that you're involved in. Are there anything for the future? What can we look for from Willie the Bam Johnson in the next year or so?
Well, 1992, you can look forward to me being number one in the country. And within my school, I'm looking forward to having 500 students. By June. And by 1984, by 1994, I want to step back from competing and go ahead and try to...
So we have a scoop here. Are we listening that this is the last year for Willie Johnson, or what?
hoping movies, you know?
You
want to get into the movie.
And not always, I mean, it's like any other sport. Your next step is the movie. Can we look forward to seeing Willie the Bam Johnson on the big screen?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hopefully we'll see you out there. I'm sure there's been a lot of our friends that have moved on to that, and I think it's a natural thing to do because martial arts, again, is a clean sport. We're one of the few sports that still have serious heroes that everybody, young and old, can relate to. And I hope more of us get into the martial arts and get into the movies. We're going to end it now, Bam, because we've had a great time talking to you. I hope to have you back at some time, and we wish you much, much success in your travels around. And I'll be out there on the circuit watching you, judging you, and keeping you straight. So we're going to break away here again to a commercial, and when we get back, we'll be coming back with our self-defense technique of the week.
So you
want
to go to a bar tonight?
Nah, I don't want to go.
Come on, let's go.
I don't want to go.
What's wrong with you, girl? We can go.
Okay, and here we are again at our technique of the week. Again, every week we try to come to you with our very practical technique, something that we hope anybody can do. Of course, martial artists have a habit of being able to jump through the air and spin and flip, but we're assuming that you out there may or may not have 5 years of training under Master Po. So what we're going to try to attempt to do is to get into something that's a very, very practical technique. In the case that you saw earlier, we had a friendly situation, someone who was not necessarily trying to hurt the person. He was just a knucklehead. He was just being annoying. She had to deal with that situation. In this case, he grabbed, and we've all grabbed or tried to pull someone somewhere. In this case, he grabbed about arms. You grabbed me, Ava, here, straight up, with a straight grab here. She first decides, one, counter his grab. The first time, in fact, she pulled away from the opponent. He grabbed her tight, and she just said, leave me alone. In most cases, that will deal with it. That will break the hold and, you know, get them off of you. In this case here, where she realized that breaking away was not enough, he was persistent, she decided to control him. One, don't take your hand off. Secure the grab. Grab them. On two, the pull was across your body, clearing your hand here, coming down three on the wrist. Okay, once the wrist is grabbed, you're turning in with the elbow, and you'll notice with just a little bit of pressure, you drop the opponent. You see? Now watch it one more time. We're going to break it down into five counts. First the grab. First grab and secure. I'm stepping around, pulling across my chest, grabbing the wrist, bending the elbow, and then applying pressure down. Okay, now I'm going to let you work it on me so you get a chance to break my arm instead. Okay, in this case, we're going to grab at the left side so everybody will be able to see it. And she grabs, okay, pull across, locking down with the hand on the wrist, get a slight bend in the elbow by turning the body back and applying the pressure down. Go it down. Yes, yes. Okay, very good. Thank you. Here I am with a broken wrist. It shows it doesn't take power. It's all in angles, all in pressure. Again, the idea here is that you may not be stronger than the person that grabs you. In most cases, someone weaker and smaller is not going to grab you. It's always going to be someone who is a little bit smaller, a little bit larger. So what we're talking about is a technique that takes very little pressure, a lot of talent. Practice, practice, practice makes perfect. We'll see you at the next technique next week. Okay, I'm out of here, and thanks for tuning in to Martial Arts Showcase. And remember, the only people you have to get even with are those that have done something good for you.